hands on him, and we talked about that, amen, in our last sermon. Hallelujah. The church, the opposition rose up. The high priests and the Sadducees, they did it because of jealousy. They laid their hands on the apostles. They put them in the common prison. But the angel of the Lord came through, amen, opened the doors for the apostles, hallelujah, brought them forth and told them, go, stand, speak all the words of this life. Saints of God, we pick up this morning in verse 18. And the title of this sermon is Standing in the Temple. Say that with me. Standing in the Temple. That's the title. And we'll have several points this morning, y'all. I got a little bit of time, but I'm going to try to get it all out. Hallelujah. In our time. But I know y'all not in a rush, no football this morning. You know what I'm saying? We can do what we got to do. Hallelujah. So let's begin. Our first point is when they heard. And it comes from verse 21. The Bible says, and when they heard that, they entered into the temple early in the morning and taught. Let's break this word down. And when they, who's the day they talking about? They're talking about the apostles, the disciples, the ones that were arrested. When they heard, well, what did they hear? We get that from our previous verses. They're talking about the conversation they had with the angel. Well, what did the angel tell them? The angel told them, go, stand, and speak. Where? In the temple. And so when they heard that, the Bible says, they entered into the temple. Now, wait one second here, all right? God gave me a revelation with that. When they heard, you know? The angel told them, go stand, speak in the temple. Now, the natural man would have said, hold up there, cowboy, you know? Go back to the place where they arrested us at. Go back to the temple. Go back to the place where the high priest is centrally located. Go back to the place where they hate us the most. Go back to the place where they're waiting for us at. You see? And God gave me a revelation in that. You see, sometimes God will tell you to do things that won't be easy. Right? Sometimes God will lead you places that won't feel good. Sometimes God will tell you to do things that may even be, from a logical standpoint, maybe a little bit crazy. All right? But what we have to understand is that God's ways are higher than our ways. And his thoughts are above our thoughts. And as the heavens are higher than the earth, so are his ways higher than our ways. Listen to me good. Christian, Hebrew, just because some ain't easy, don't mean it's not God, saints. Are you hearing me up in here? You think the Exodus was easy? You think going through the wilderness was easy? You think standing at that Red Sea while Pharaoh was on their back was easy? You think waiting for bread to come down from heaven was easy? You think going in there fighting against the Amalekites, the Canaanites, the Perizzites, the termites, just seeing if y'all listen, you think that was easy? And a lot of times what we do, if it ain't easy, we say it must not be God. And boy, the devil is a liar. Let me tell you something. Because sometimes God will lead you in the valley. Sometimes the Spirit will take you into the wilderness. Sometimes God will bring you to a hard place, a tough place. But that tough place is not to break you. It's to make you. Come on, somebody. Amen. Amen. But we stand there not wanting to go. Amen. I'm telling you here. Go. He's going to be with us to walk on the water. He's going to be the fourth man in the fire with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. When he put us in a tough place, don't worry. He's going to send his angel to shut the mouth of the lions. Hey, God. We got to do what God says and leave the consequences up to him. Anybody hear me up in here? The Bible says when they heard. The second point of the morning is, amen. The Bible says, hallelujah, right clear. It says they entered into the temple. Here it is. When they heard the command of the angel, go to the temple. The Bible says they entered into the temple. I love that. You see? Because even though the command was tough, even though they may have had their doubts, even though they probably said, listen, we just got out of jail, man. I'm still on probation and parole. I don't want to go back. I'm just joking. But I'm just saying. You know what I'm saying? I do say that, huh? Hallelujah. Yeah. The Bible says when they got the command, they went to the temple. I love that. I love that. Obedience. Obedience. You know, the Bible says obedience is better than sacrifice. We got a lot of people sacrificing, but not too many obeying. All right? We willing to do something great for God, but the everyday obedience is what we falter in. And God teaches us, amen. It's the little foxes that spoil the vine. God would rather you do what he say than go beyond what he say. You know, my daddy, we used to work together, amen. My daddy was kind of like a jack of all trades. He did some electrical, he did some plumbing, you know what I'm saying? Wasn't too much he didn't do. And me and G Money, we would work with my daddy in the summers, amen. And I remember one time, hallelujah, we was washing a house for him, big old house in the Oil Center. We was washing a house. It was one of the houses of the lawyers, amen, back in the day. And my daddy told me to do specific things, all right? And I didn't do what he said. But I saw a big project, all right? And I said, boy, my daddy would love if I did this. So they had this big cast iron gate, probably worth about $10,000, you know? And so I said, G Money, get on the other side of that. We're going to move this so we could do this extra piece, and my daddy going to be proud. Me and G Money picked that big gate up, and that big gate began to go back down. And when it went down, it broke that gate. And I could never forget when my daddy walked up to me. I said, Daddy, but I was just trying to do something extra for you. He said, look, before you do something extra for me, do what I've already told you to do. Just obey me. You ain't got to sacrifice nothing for me. Just obey me, you know? And he was mad. You know what I'm saying? But I learned something. He taught me a valuable lesson. Obedience. Let me teach you something else about obedience while I'm here. All right? When God tells you something, God don't want us to procrastinate in obeying him. All right? God never wants to be placed on hold. All right? When God tells us something, God don't want us to say, okay, God, I'm going to get to it. Oh, no, 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 no. That's not how he operates. You see? There's a saying in the church, delayed obedience is disobedience. Meaning that when God tells you something, if you wait too long, you could go do exactly what God wants you to do, but you didn't do it in the time that God wanted, and it's disobedience. Let me give you an example of that. When God told Israel, go ahead and possess the land, he told them, he said, listen, here it is. You got the promise, I'm with you, and if God be for you, who could be against you? But they came back and the spies went in and Joshua Caleb said one thing, the other 10 say, but there's giants in the land and we look like grasshoppers. We not going to go. And God said, all right, well, y'all going to stay in the wilderness, but y'all going to have to stay there 40 years till all of y'all die. They said, God, we change our mind. We going to go now. But it was a delayed obedience. And God said, nah, you ain't going nowhere now. Because when the window of opportunity was there, you didn't seize the opportunity. All right? The word that I have for you, listen, when you get a word from God, you got to hear him. You got to justify and know that it's him, running through the word, make sure that it's him. All right? All right? You got to stay still enough and quiet enough and get in your quiet place with God to be able to hear a word from God. You got to ask God for confirmation. God, if that's you, confirm it. You got to lay out a fleece like Gideon, you know? You got to seek wise counsel. The Bible says there's safety in the multitude of counsel. But when you do your work to confirm a word of God and you know it's God, don't delay in obeying him. You get to it immediately, you know? The psalmist says, amen, in Psalm 119, verse 16. When he knew that he had a word from God, look what he says. I made haste and delayed not to keep thy commandments. You know, God is an on-time God. He's a meticulous God. In fact, he runs creation like the gears of a clock. Everything moving at its proper time. Everything. Everything. That's why he could say in Esther, hallelujah, you was born for such a time as this. You wouldn't have been right for that time. You wouldn't have been right for this time. But for the time that you're in right now, you're born for such a time as this. And I prophesied it on every single person right here. This is your time. What you have, hallelujah, on the inside of you, amen, has been purposely and intentionally given, hallelujah, to handle the needs and the will of God for the day in which we're living in. You see, that's how meticulous he is. And his detail goes even into the cross and salvation. The Bible says in Galatians 4:4 that when the fullness of time, somebody say the fullness. God bless you. Hallelujah. The fullness of time. The fullness means when a woman is expecting. And she at that place, amen, where she can't hold on no more. The water done broke, amen. And listen, let me tell you, she's so full that there's nothing that you can do, amen. But we're not at the hospital yet. It don't matter. It's the fullness of time. We ain't got the paramedics yet. It don't matter. It's the fullness of time. Hey, God, I don't have the epidural. I don't have this. It don't matter. It's the fullness of time. We on the city bus. It don't matter. It's the fullness of time. Because when the fullness of time happens, hey, whatever God done predestined, it will happen. Oh, come on, somebody. He's an on-time God. You see what I'm saying? And so obedience to him when he give you a word is important. It's like a coach telling you to get off the bench and come in the game. You don't tell the coach, coach, hold on. No, I need you for this play right now. That's what God does. Don't delay. Look, Charles Spurgeon says this. He says, speed and repentance and speed and obedience are two excellent things. We are too often in haste. That means in a hurry. We're too often in a hurry to sin, but not in a hurry to obey. You remember how you used to run to sin? They never had to call you. Hey, come back here. Come back here. I got you. Because I need to say this one. They didn't call you twice when the party was on. They didn't have to knock on your house long to go to the club. In fact, you was out there waiting for them, sitting out there waiting. Well, where they at? You was in a hurry to go sin. That girl ain't had to call you twice. You know? She pick up phone, you coming by? I'm already, I'm pulling up right now. Yeah. But God is trying to say, listen, the same way you was in a hurry to do the devil, be in a hurry to do God. Come on, be in a hurry to do God. Be in a hurry to do God. Listen. They got the order to go to the temple. They went to the temple. The Bible says in the morning, the very next morning, early in the morning, when the temple opened, it was there. You see what I'm saying? They were there. All right? Come on, let's move to the third point. Y'all still up out there? Y'all still awake out there? Amen. Hallelujah. Number three, they called the council together. Here it is. And when they heard that, they entered into the temple early in the morning and taught. But the high priest came, and they that were with him, and called the council together, and all the senate of the children of Israel, and sent to the prison to have them brought. Now listen, hallelujah. They didn't know that the angel led the apostles, the disciples, out of prison. They didn't know that, all right? And so they gathered the senate, which is called the Sanhedrin, 70 elders of Israel. And they gathered another committee together. It was called the Judiciary Committee, which was made up of 46 judges that were in the outer court and the inner court, 23 apiece. And so all in was like 116 people came in, all the best minds, all the money of Israel, people like Joseph of Arimathea, people like Nicodemus, amen. This was the best of the best. This was the politicians. This was the Harvard Ivy League schoolers, amen. These are the people that own all the businesses. These are the people that had all the knowledge of Torah, amen. People like Gamaliel, doctors of the law. This, I'm talking about, listen, this was the cream of the crop of Israel. They all came together, right? All came together. And we saw them come together before like this. We saw them come together before. We saw them come together on the night our Lord was betrayed. When they had sent Judas. And when Judas said, the one that I kiss, that's the one, grab him. When Judas kissed him, he said, betrayest thou me with a kiss? Amen. And they apprehended him and took him into custody and drug him before a council. And I'm going to tell you here, that's that same council right there. And they had gathered together to do wrong once again. They had killed the Lord, and now they're going to try to kill his disciples. But I'm here to tell you that though hand joined in hand, the wicked shall not go unpunished. And no matter what, hallelujah, weapon is formed against you, it's not going to prosper. Listen to me. They gathered themselves. It reminds me of Psalm 2. When the Bible says, why do the heathen rage and imagine a vain thing? Hey, y'all know what the Bible says. And set themselves against the Lord and his anointed. They say, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords. The Bible says, even when they come together like that to do you harm, the Bible says, he that sit in the heaven shall laugh. They've come to break y'all apart, but the Lord shall have them in derision. Come on, give the Lord some glory. Amen. Well, what's the word, Pastor? Listen, it don't matter how they come against you, whether it's on your job, in your family, whether they're coming against the church, amen, and Christians in this modern day in which we live in, whether they come against you as a Hebrew, amen, and this uprising, this awakening of our people, it don't matter who come against you. It doesn't matter at all. It don't matter how many degrees they have. They can have more degrees than a thermometer. It don't matter. You know why? Because the Most High is with us. The Most High is with us. Anybody hear me up in here? I always heard in the church, amen, that it doesn't matter who's on the other side. Because one man or one woman with God is a majority. You with me so far? All right? Numbers don't mean nothing. And you got to remember that. In your life, be courageous. In your life, do great exploits. Don't worry about your family name. Don't worry about how much education you had. Don't worry about, amen, your rap sheet, your criminal record. That's stuff that keep unbelievers down. That's stuff that keep people that's not connected to God. Listen, if God be for us, who can be against us? Nothing can hold us down. Why? Because they can't hold him down. It reminds me of the story of Gideon, saints. If you don't know it, Gideon is in the book of Judges. You can read chapters 6, 7, and 8. And it's a remarkable story. Amen. It's a story of Israel in sin, Israel in poverty, Israel in bondage. Amen. And it's all because they disobeyed the Most High and they found themselves in the most deplorable conditions. But the Bible says, amen, that God won't forget his people. And he always going to raise up a remnant. He always going to send a savior, always going to send a judge. Amen. And the Bible tells us that God sent an angel. Glory to God. He sent an angel to a man named Gideon who was hiding out. Amen. Hallelujah. Trying to thresh wheat so nobody could see him because the Midianites was even stealing the very wheat of the Israelites back then. The angel come there and he say, hallelujah. He say, hail, mighty man of God. Mighty man of valor. And Gideon look at it and he look around. He must not be talking about me because I'm hiding from the Midianites now. But how many people know that God can see some things in you that you can't even see in yourself? Huh? Hallelujah. The angel teaches us to speak life. Don't speak dead, speak life. Huh, Brother John? Speak life over our marriage, over our children, over our husband, over our wives. Amen. Hallelujah. You call him a dead bum and you'd be surprised where he end up a dead bum. Speak life. The angel said you're a mighty man of valor. Even though his current situation was cowardice, you're a mighty man of valor. You were a faithful man. Even though his current situation, amen, is a womanizer, you were a faithful man. Hey, you a business owner, even though his current situation is a drug dealer. Hey, God, you a man of God, even though his current situation is an unbelieving heathen. Hey, you're born again, even though their current situation is a prodigal. You're holy. Even though the current situation is an addict, we learn like our God to speak those things that are not as though they were and they shall come to pass. Come on, give God some glory. Hallelujah. We need to speak some life over the Hebrews, huh? Come on now, you're not drug dealers. You're not prostitutes. You educated. You the head and not the tail. You above and not beneath. You a lender, not a borrower. You're blessed in the city. You're blessed in the field. You're blessed when you come and when you go. Anything your hands touch shall live. Hey, you will not die on welfare. You will not die on food stamps. Hey, God. You don't have high blood pressure no more. Your diet is going to be edifying. Amen. You're going to eat the right things and you're going to live long and a prosperous life. Hey, God, you coming out. You're rising up. And as a nation, you will realize who you are and whose you are in Jesus' name. Come on, give God some glory. Hallelujah. Back to the numbers. Back to the numbers. The council gathered together. But it doesn't matter. And in Gideon's situation, the Midianites were as the number of the sand of the seashore. And Gideon rallies up an army, man, you know what I'm saying? Might be 20,000. It wasn't enough. But he said, listen, I'm still going to take my little 20, 30,000. We're going to fight because God is with us. But how many people know that sometimes, amen, God don't want to move by 10 or 20 or 30,000? So he told Gideon, he said, Gideon, you got too many people. Wait up, God, what do you mean we got too many people? Last time I checked, they had more than us. Well, you check wrong. If I'm with you, you always got more than them. Amen? So he told Gideon, and some of y'all, I don't know, second service, you might not have read the story, but he told Gideon, he said, let some of the men go. He told him, ask them, how many people want to go home? How many people scared? And I bet your bunch of raised their hand. We scared. We really scared. He said, well, all right, go. God said, Gideon, you still got too many. God, I only got 10,000 now. That's still too many, Gideon. Come on, bring them by the water, and we're going to try them at the waters. Okay, God, what are we going to do? Watch how they drink. Watch how they drink. The ones they put their head under the water and don't watch what's going on around them, you don't want them to go with you at all. But the one that get down and put his hand in the water but keep his eyes to the hills from where his help come from and get a little water in his hand and he lap it up like a dog. He said, that's the ones you want. All right? The only problem with that was only 300 of them did that. So Gideon went from 10,000 to 300. And God said, all right, now we're ready. Split your 300 into three groups. Surround the Midianites. I'm going to give y'all some new weapons, some new advanced technology. What you going to give us? A torch. You know what I'm saying? Some pottery from Pottery Barn. You know that? That's what I'm going to give you, some pottery. And I'm going to give you a trumpet. God, where are we going to St. Martinville Parade? What's happening? Why we got trumpets and pottery? What are we going to do? What's going on? But sometimes, listen, God's idea is going to sound crazy. When you can't afford building like this, God's going to say, this is your building. But God, what they asking for a month? We can't make in 3 months. God, what are we going to do? So Gideon go out with his jars of clay, with his torch. Put the jar of clay on the torch. Got his trumpet. They surround the Midianites. And Gideon say, when you hear me, when I give the signal, go ahead and shout as loud as you can. Break the jar of clay and let the light shine, which is a revelation within itself. That was a word right there. You see, we all jars of clay. But we got the excellency of God's spirits on the inside of us. Amen. But if we would just learn how to break the clay and let the light shine on, you don't know what's in you. If you would just learn how to break the clay, be broken, a broken and a contrite heart, God will never despise. If we would just be broken, humble ourselves and say, God, not me, but you. You do it. I can't do it. You take. He said, break the clay. Break the clay. And when you break the clay, the light gonna shine. When the light shine, hey, the enemy gonna be sent into confusion. That's just what happened. It was all dark. The Midianites were sleeping. You know that drooling sleep that you go when it's really good? It's time you can wake up, it's all the whole side wet. But you don't care, you just done got some good sleep. You're all sleeping, you know? And all of a sudden, pitch dark, they hear, ah, the sword of the Lord and the sword of Gideon. Pow! And they look up, lights all around. The light. The light. The light. The light. Then they blew the trumpet. Sound the alarm. Blow the shofar. Jubilee is here. No more bondage. You know you blow the trumpet when you done won something. They say, hey, we're going to blow it before the battle because the battle is not ours, but the battle is the Lord. They sound the trumpet because they knew that the victory it was. The Bible say the enemy went in confusion. They began stabbing one another. They didn't know where the enemy was. And that's the way God is. When God will show up, it don't really matter the numbers, y'all. Because if God with you, he going to make your enemies fight against one another. Amen. They're going to move you out. Get out the way. I'm after him. You see what I'm saying? So the council came together. But it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at all. If God be for you, who can be against you? And I'm waiting for some miracles in this time. I'm waiting for some miracles, right? You got some vision, some idea, some businesses that you want to start, some jobs you want to apply for, some investments that you want to make, amen? God is birthing something in you. It's a new season. It's a new time. He's giving his people bigger vision than the hood. Don't you see yourself seeing things outside the hood? He is broadening our horizon and our hearts. We being bigger than the hood right now. Right? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And that's what he's doing. All right? And we got to be ready for that. And when he give you a vision, amen, don't you dare sit there in unbelief. Have faith. But I ain't went to school for that. So what? He did. You understand what I'm saying? He omniscient. He know everything. You know what I'm saying? Lord, how are we going to do that? How are we going to provide? You're not the provider. Yahweh, Jireh is the provider. Amen? Yeah. Yeah. I'm opening a business right now that I'm doing. You know? And what I'm doing is a lot. It's a lot. It's a lot. I got to learn again. I had to take some tests. I had to go get some licenses. I'm studying, man. My wife like, boy, I ain't saw you study for school in a long time. I said, babe, all I want to study is the word. I don't even want to study this. But sometimes you got to stretch yourself. Sometimes you got to get out your comfort zone. Sometimes you got to go back to school. You got to get a certification. Sometimes you got to get that life. Just don't stand there and do nothing. Give God something to work with. And try it. Try it. I would rather try and fail than never try and for sure fail. You see, if the gun go off and I at least get off the mark and run, I have a chance to win. But if I don't even get in the race, then a loss is for sure. Who I'm talking to in here? Do it. Do it. The movement needs you. You see? Fourth point, sent to prison. Sent to prison. The Bible says in verse 21, and when they heard that, they entered into the temple early in the morning and taught. But the high priest came and they that were with him and called the council together and all the senate of the children of Israel and sent to the prison to have them brought. So here it is. The story is simple. The angel busts them out of prison, but the Sanhedrin don't know it. They gather everybody together. Listen, they're going to have a meeting. They're going to persecute them. They're going to probably try to set them up, false witnesses, try to crucify them, try to kill them. Amen. Woo, but no weapon formed against you gonna prosper. And every tongue that rises up against you shall be condemned. You see? And so they all meet together and they talk about the disciples and they say, Kelly, go get them in prison where we put them last time. Go get them and bring them here. We ready for them. We gonna deal with them boys. Go get them in that prison. The only thing is they didn't know that the prison was empty. Somebody said the prison was empty. You see? And that's the truth. The prison was empty. The revelation that God gave me is this. Some people will think that you're in the same place where you was when they left you. But in the interim of them last knowing you, and them last leaving you, and them last being in fellowship with you, something has happened in the interim. There was some intervening circumstances. There was a divine appointment. God sent an angel. And what I'm saying is that God moved. Somebody say, God moved. Yeah. They're going to go back to where you were. Looking for you. But God moved. They're going to invite you to come to the club and do what y'all used to do. But God moved. They're going to stop by the house with the drink and the alcohol. But God moved. They're going to pull up with a car full of women and say, let's go. But they don't realize that God moved. They're going to come knock by the house where you used to live, in the hood and in the project. But they don't realize that you're on 2 acres now in the country. They don't realize that God moved. They're going to look for your little old car that you had to push start and jump in before it get going. Hallelujah. The one you turn off and it would never stop. And they would see that little car by the store and say, I thought you was in the store because I saw the hoopty. But they don't realize you riding 2016 and 2017. They don't realize that God moved. What I'm saying is that they went to the place where they last put them. But God moved. And they wasn't there. They wasn't there. And so they asked the guards. They say, what you mean they're not there? What you mean? Did y'all lock the doors? And the guards answer them. They say, man, listen. You see? What verse we on? Go to 23. You see? Go to 23. And the guards say in 23, they say, man, truly we found the prison, truly we found shut. It was locked. It was closed. Door was closed and it was locked. With all safety. And the keeper standing without before the doors. The guards was. So the door was closed and it was locked. The prison guards were standing outside, you know, keeping watch over nothing, you know. But when we opened the doors, we found no man within. The disciples were gone. So everything that was used to keep them in was still there. The bars, the locks, the guards, their swords, the handcuffs, everything that was put in place to keep them down was still there. But God had sprung them loose. As a people, we see a system placed upon Christians and Hebrews alike. A system made to keep the people of God down. Whether it's through the educational system, the Ashkenazi educational system. Whether it's through the media and the TV, amen. There's a system there. And a lot of times you can find yourselves being a little bit dissuaded and doubtful. When you see the enormity of what's coming against the move of God. But what I'm telling you is that God can move in such a fashion that everything that was holding the movement down could still be in place. But God will move in spite of that. Anybody hear me up in here? You'll look inside. No man is there. No man is there. What you saying, Pastor? They can continue doing that music. But when they look for somebody to listen to it, no man is there. They could continue, hey, God, having that evolution and evolution in their schools and having a bus pass through our neighbors to pick up our kids and indoctrinate them in the Luciferian ways. They can continue that system. But when we wake up, they're going to look in their schools and no man is there. You understand what I'm saying? They can have all those things on TV showing us, amen, adultery, fornication, drug dealing, the BETs, the MTVs. They can have all of that still going on. All the devilish system and web to keep us down, that can all still be there. But when we arise and awake and they look for people to watch that stuff, no man will be there. Nobody there. I can't wait till it happens. But we refuse the delicacies of the king's table. Refuse those things that defile us. And they will find no man there. Yeah, my friends, they sent to the prison to look for them where they were supposed to be. And no man was there. Verse 5, we find, point number 5, we found no man. Y'all still up out there? Y'all awake? All right. We found no man. Hallelujah. The Bible says, hallelujah, in verse 23, saying the prison truly we found shut and all safety. The keeper standing without before the doors. But within we opened, we found no man within. Did I do that point already? I think I did do that point when I did send to prison. But I'm following the Spirit, and the Lord must know that my time is running short, so I did 2 points in one. So let's go on to the 6th point. Amen. Hallelujah. Doubted where this would grow. The Bible says, now when the high priest, the captain of the temple, and the chief priest heard these things, they doubted of them whereunto this would grow. This thing is written a little bit funny in the King James. Amen. But the spirit of it is simple. You see, they was trying to stop the move of God. The Sadducees and the Pharisees, they were used to what they believed, but a new covenant was coming in. A new testament, a new move of God was coming in. All right? But they were so comfortable in their beliefs. Sometimes you can get so comfortable in your belief, in your religion, that when God moves, you try to fight God move. And that's a bad place to be. That's when you get too comfortable. That's when you can't move with God. The Bible says God, the Spirit of God, is like the wind. He listed where he will. We up here trying to tell God how his move should go. Well, God is moving in the New Testament. And he's doing miracles and signs and wonders. And remember, the Sadducees don't even believe in miracles. They don't even believe in the supernatural. They don't even believe in the spirit or hell or anything like that. And so they said, listen, people getting healed, people getting saved. We got to stop these miracles. How we stop these miracles? Arrest them. Put them in common prison. I don't want to hear about another miracle, because if somebody hear about another miracle, hey, God, they're going to put our old religion out of business. And everybody's going to be in the church and nobody in the synagogue. So they arrest him to stop the miracles. But I love what the Bible tells us. The Bible says that all things work together for the good of those that love God and are called according to his purpose. The old folk used to say, hallelujah, whatever the devil means for bad in your life, God's going to always turn it around for good. And the very thing, amen, that the devil do to try to stop you will be the thing that God used to exalt you. Oh, I'm telling you. That's the type of God we serve. You know, I'm telling you, man, I don't know why the devil keep fighting against him. Because he always turn around the worst thing that the devil do to be the best thing. That's what the cross was. That he would send his only begotten son. You know? The heir. He would send the heir apparent from heaven to earth. If there was anybody that the devil would hate the most, would be the son that's the express image of the Father. He hate us. And we just an offshot image. But this one, when you done seen the son, you done seen the Father. I know he hated him. And what the demons did, the devils did, we're going to get him. We're going to tempt him in all points. They did that, but he was in all point tempted like us, yet without sin. He overcame. They blasphemed. They talk about him. You know what I'm saying? He was reviled, but he still didn't revile back. Everything they threw at him, amen, he told him, he said, listen, the prince of this world has come, but he had found nothing in me. Nothing. And said, we know what we're going to do with him. We're going to kill him. We're going to kill him. So they set up a traitor in his own team. They put false witnesses. They put jealousy in the Pharisees and the Sadducees. They set him up. They bring him. They put him in a kangaroo court. Amen. Violate every court law, every Roman law to put him up on that cross. And they crucified him there, clowning him, telling him, if you be the Son of God, come on down from that cross. Then we're going to believe. But the very thing the devil did to insult our God the most is the very thing that God will use to save his people and to bring him glory in the most. Anybody hear me up in here? Because what they didn't know is after they would kill the Son of Man, that on the third day he would rise again with all power and all might. For had the princes of this age known what the Son of God would have done, they would have never crucified him. The very thing they used to try to defeat God would be the weapon that God would use to bring the devil's kingdom down. Hey! What you saying, Pastor? I'm telling you here. They put him in jail to stop him, but it only blessed him. There's some things in your life that the devil... Come back here. Come back here, microphone. There's some things in your life that the devil has strategically placed in your life. When you was coming up, some abuses, some molestations, some relationships with your mom and your daddy that wasn't right, some memories of infidelity, amen, some things that the devil, amen, intentionally placed. Hallelujah. Brother Singleton was talking about it. Amen. Hallelujah. Even in his poem, there's some things that the devil has placed in your life to handicap you. To make it to where you can't fulfill what God has for you. Because you're carrying that dead leg. And every time you try to, it's time to run. It's time to run that race and be what you can be. God call you out and you say, I'm ready, God, but I can't. They abused me, God. God, that uncle, he touched me. God, they used to leave me at home by myself. My daddy never signed my birth certificate. They never loved me, God. Oh, my husband cheated on me. God, they abandoned me. I can't move, God. That same old leg. But what God wants to do with that old leg, we serve a God that makes all things new. Anybody hear me? He want to come down and put that old leg in rehab. He want to be a wonderful counselor and a prince of peace in your life. He want to save you, and give you beautiful ashes, amen. And give you, God, a spirit of prayer, a garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. And there you go in rehab, and rehab don't feel good. In fact, rehab hurt more than the injury. But there you go, you working out that leg, and God, that leg is bending, And a lot of the times, hallelujah, the one that was injured, after proper rehab and proper workout and proper, hallelujah, attention, that leg that was the worst can become the very best. The leg that you get your best. That place where you're the weakest will wind up being the place where you're the strongest. And nobody gonna be able to minister out of that place like you. Nobody. The very thing they meant to break you, God will use to make you. I'm telling you. We only know about Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego because of the fire. We only hear about Daniel because of the lions then. You don't understand that your test is really your testimony. But it's all about perspective. Because the test is looking at it from the beginning. The testimony is looking at it from the end. I just want you to change your perspective. Stop seeing things from the beginning. And begin to look at it as God would look at it. How is this thing going to end? And what is it going to do to me? What is it going to produce in me? How is it going to bless me? How is it going to make me strong? What is God going to do through this? What? Hey! He'll try to stop a miracle in your life and mess around, give you a bigger miracle. He will try to quench the testimony in your life and mess around, give you a bigger testimony. I'm telling you here, God is writing your story, and he's doing it for his glory. As I think back upon my life, the things that brought me the most pain are the things that made me who I am. Those things did things to me. All the tears and the wet pillows and the struggle, amen. They are the reason I am who I am. They're the reason I preach like I preach. I teach like I teach. I worship like I worship. I connect like I connect. Those things. Hey! Yeah. Hallelujah. Let God use it. Let God have his way. Let him finish his masterpiece. Stop judging every single one of his strokes and wait for him to finish the picture. What you doing? That's not a pretty color, God. I don't like that. You out of the lines on this one. Let the master work. Come on, give him some glory. Amen. Listen. Hallelujah. Last point, kept you long enough, is standing in the temple. The Bible says that, hallelujah, they were perplexed, confused. They didn't know what to do. They were like, man, we put him in prison and the guards are there. The doors are locked. The bars are up. Hallelujah. And nobody's in there. You see? They were perplexed. What are we going to do? Where are they? Did they? What happened? You know? And then news came. News came. It says, behold, the men whom ye put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching the people. This is preposterous. Listen to me. I've been in the legal system for a long time. And every jailbreak I saw, every time a brother got loose and free, he never go back to the place where he was arrested. You understand what I'm saying? That brother is trying to get to Canada or Mexico. That's where he's trying to get. He up in there like Harry Tubman trying to get to the Northern Star. He is not, you know what I'm saying? What's going on here is that the disciples end up on the same premises as the leadership of Israel at the time. They left the prison, went back to the temple, and they were right under the nose of the Sadducees. They're like, where are they? We'll never get them again. They probably halfway to Damascus by now. And the room right next to us, preaching and teaching in the temple. Here's the revelation. When God take your test and turn it into a testimony. When God take your mess and turn it into a masterpiece. Wherever you are right now and you can't see it and it hurts so bad, amen, but God is about to do a thing that if he told you, you wouldn't believe it. I'm speaking it on you. You wouldn't even believe it. You wouldn't even believe it. You wouldn't even believe it. They've had some people with your anointing that's misused it. I'm in the same situation. But when people misuse the anointing, God looks for a vessel that'll really use the anointing. So those that we thought was something in music but misused the gift, God say, "Ooh, God, I got to take that from Saul and put that on a David. I gotta find me somebody that can do these movies, do these productions. I have to find somebody to do this." Now, when your story is complete, what I'm saying is, don't forget where you came from. Don't forget where you came from, man. Don't let him give it to you. And I'm speaking to myself too. You know what I'm saying? Don't let him give you something and change that test into a testimony and you forget your people. Don't forget your people. Where did they end up? They end up in the temple. But what were they doing? They were teaching the people. Your story is not even really for you. Your story is for somebody else. You see, faith coming by hearing, and hearing by the word of the Lord. And when our brother got up there and he began to prophesy and he began to talk about houses and refrigerators, and my wife looked at me, she said, "Oh, he's ministering to somebody." He was telling his story. And we overcome the devil by the blood of the Lamb, but also by the word of our testimony. Oh, God, man. I gotta go. But listen to me good. Go back to your people. Stand in the temple. Tell them what God has done for you. Publish his praises. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Open your mouth. Don't let the rocks outcry you. Don't let the rocks praise more than you. You tell them, if he did it for me, he will do it for you. Hey, you begin to shout unto God and give them your testimony. And don't forget, most of all, to give them Yahshua Jesus Christ. Because we would never be who we are today without the one who gave his life for us on Calvary. If you're here today and you would say, "Pastor, I feel that there's something in me that's bigger than me. I want to do great things." I want to tell you that doing great things start off with you connecting with the greatest, and that's the Savior. The way you connect with him this morning is you admit that you are a sinner, but you place all your faith, your confidence, your hope in him. You see, the ones that hope in the Lord, that's the ones that's going to do great things. Because victory is not by might nor by strength, but by my spirit, saith the Lord. I don't know about you, but in life, I don't want to do what Omar can do. I want to do what God can do. I want to run into a situation and then look back and say, "Can you believe what just happened?" That's what I want. That's what I want. I want to be like the people I read about in our book right here. I say, Saul has slayed his thousands, but David his 10,000s. When my time is up, I want to be known as a giant slayer. But it begins with connecting with the greatest. You admit you're a sinner. You believe in him as your Lord and Savior, and you ask him, "Lord, save me a sinner." You only have not because you ask not. God is waiting on us to invite him in. He says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock." He's at the door of your heart right now. The only difference between your life and the life of abundant life is one turn of a doorknob. Just an invitation. And then you're going to confess him as your Lord. I'm going to open up the altar. I know it's late, amen, but Sometimes you just gotta move with the Spirit. Sometimes you gotta tarry sometimes. I just wanna open up the doors of the church and listen to me good. Now listen to me good. If you're here and there's any doubt of your salvation, you're gonna come and we're gonna invite Jesus into your heart. You'll never be the same again. Secondly, if you're already a Christian, but some kind of way you're not living up to your potential, you've backslidden, you've fallen away, or maybe you hadn't been as courageous in stepping out for God like you should, I want to pray for you as well. Or maybe you sense greatness, but there's a hurdle in your way. I want to pray that you would arise to all the potential that God has for you. I don't want to get to heaven, y'all, and God look at me and say, you know, you did all right, but there was so much more. I want him to say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. You did everything you were supposed to do. Listen, I'm open up the altar. I'm open up the altar. If you're here and you qualify for any of those characteristics or you need prayer, come on up and pray with Pastor. Come on up and pray with Pastor. Don't let nothing keep you in your seat, because greatness is calling you. Greatness is calling you. Greatness is calling you. The movement is calling you. The clarion call for a people bigger than themselves. We're looking for sea walkers. We're looking for sea splitters. We're looking for, hallelujah, people that will walk through the fire with the Most High God. We're looking for giant slayers. We're looking for Jehoshaphats again and King Uzziahs again. We're looking for Deborahs again. We're looking for Samsons again, but greater than Samsons, Davids, greater than Davids again. You see, you read those stories and you think that the best is behind us. But when you understand the character of God, He always saves the best for last. Your latter end shall be greater than your beginning. You ready to pray with me now? Somebody say, God, Most High, Yahweh, I come to you in the name of your Son, Jesus, Yahshua, the Christ. I admit I've messed up. I've done some things that I'm not proud of, but I'm sorry. Please forgive me of all my sins. I believe with all my heart that you love me in spite of me. I believe you died on the cross for all my sins. I believe you buried in the grave. And on the third day, I believe you rose with all power and all might. Jesus, come and live inside my heart. I open the doors and I invite you in. Make a home in my heart. Clean up if you want. Rearrange some things. But please, don't leave me like you found me. Oh, I need you. Fill me with your Spirit. Give me faith. Confidence. Let me do great things for you while I'm on earth. I confess that you are my King, my Lord, my Savior, my everything. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, give God some glory. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Saints, we're going to go. Remember, in the foyer, we got a lot of things for you out there. Amen. We got tables. Go check it out. Amen. But y'all have a blessed day. Realize that God's going to do some great things through you. Well, may the Lord bless you. May He keep you. May He cause His face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up His